Hi, I'm Chrisi Karvonides, and welcome to the UCLA Design Showcased West Salon event. Our panel today is featuring costume designers from three Netflix series: Justine Seymour, costume designer from The Orthodox; Michelle Cole, costume designer from Black AF; and Beth Morgan is returning for the third season as the costume designer for Glow. So let's get started. First, our first guest will be Justine, who's a costume designer for TV and feature films working across Australia, Asia, America, and is joining us today from Berlin. Let's see our first trailer featuring Justine Seymour's work on Unorthodox.
You escaped, didn't you?
You make it sound like I was in prison.
Weren't you?
No. But I left without telling anyone.
Why did you leave?
God expected too much of me.
The shadchen not ungetrogen emetsen.
Wo svar bucher is er?
Ir es vejeden einem, geherig.
Ich bin anders wie die andere Meidle.
Anders is ki.
Where I come from, there are many rules.
Und es ist da ein heilige Pflicht, sie mit keinem Sander nutzen erscheint.
My family just cares that I'm a good wife and mother.
Ins mismer Opum stimmt, sie gefällt dir nicht.
I had to get as far as possible from my community. So, will you help me?
Your ticket, passport. Good luck in Berlin.
Where are you from, Steve?
New York. Never been anywhere else.
Dann lass sie doch mal was Schönes zeigen.
Talmud says, if not me, then who? If not now, then when?
Justine Seymour, welcome, welcome. So let's start with, you created this incredible world that's supposed to be Brooklyn, New York Orthodox community. How did you start to compile all that research?
Well, first of all, I'd like to say thank you very much for having me. It's lovely to be here. And it was lovely to see that little clip that's been cut together. I started the project the way I saw every project that has an element that I'm unfamiliar with, and that is with an enormous amount of research. And that started by actually me reading the book that Deborah wrote. Then I read a couple of other books on Hasidic Jewish communities. I watched lots of documentaries. I watched television shows and movies set amongst Hasidic communities. And then I actually went to Brooklyn and I spent 1 week just doing research there with the team. And then I went back about a month later to do buying. And that's, you know, I just think the most important part about moving into a world that's unfamiliar is that you get as much information as you can from the source.
And then you're just living and breathing the whole, you know, talk about world building and what you've created here. So should we take a first look at the first image of Essie in Williamsburg? And to an untrained eye, it's almost like it could be clothing off the rack, but it's very unique, their choices. How did you show the hierarchy of all the women in this community?
Well, that's a very good question. So I suppose the pinnacle of the hierarchy is her mother-in-law, who's played is Miriam, the character Miriam. And I chose to use more expensive clothes on her, or expensive looking, really. Yeah. I used the Ferragamo scarves on her and a few designery type tops. And I really focused on making her look very well put together with her color palette, and everything matched and everything was quite sophisticated. And as it trickled down and I finally reached Esty, I made her just more simple. And even though her clothes look like they're quite complicated because there are ruffles and they're high-necked and they're modesty yes. clothing, she's actually quite simply dressed, and she is still just really a young girl. She's really only 19, and I wanted to try and have an innocence to her, and I really wanted to show her willingness to actually make her relationship work.
Right.
And she was very excited about getting married and becoming a woman and doing God's work by creating children. It's just that that wasn't her path, and well, we know what happened.
Well, before she gets swallowed up in the burden of what is put upon her, we see this incredible moment of her having this wedding dress that is this confection. Let's pull up that image of the wedding dress and your sketch of it. And there are many, what we saw in the preview are the layers of three different types of head coverings and veils. What is all that representing?
Well, within the Satmar community, and I can only really speak for that community because that's the one I studied, the women are marrying a man, and it's not really like a personal situation. That's why the head is covered. It's about being married to do God's work as opposed to getting married for a romantic endeavor. And so the first veil is very simple, and the husband doesn't really see her looking like that. That's just for the women as they're separated within the ceremony. And then the other veil comes on, which covers the whole of her face, and that's what she actually gets married in. And so he's marrying the vessel of God, and with lots of prayers to help her along her way. And she's very excited and very nervous. And I wanted that dress to represent the joy that she was feeling in turning into a woman. And then she knew that she was going to be finally accepted within her community because she had made that leap into womanhood. And that's what everyone wanted for her, because she had been quite a, you know, a challenging child, asking a lot of questions and, you know, just not being as the other girls probably should have been. And then the dress, I wanted it to be very restrictive in a way, incredibly yeah. beautiful. And she was the princess of that day, but I wanted the collar to be high and a little bit tight, and I wanted the arms to be very slim and fitted. So I actually bought the dress off eBay.
I love this, right? off of eBay. Pretty incredible.
Yes. Well, you know, when you don't have a crazy amount of money to spend on wedding dresses that can be crazily expensive, and that seemed just to be the most cost-effective way for me to do it. And so we did buy a dress, but Shira Haas is a very petite actress, so we had to pull it all to pieces yeah. and then rebuild it on her very petite figure. And I wanted the pearls, which are very much celebrated within the community as a status symbol, I wanted them to almost kind of be swallowing her and restraining her, but yet her life force sort of bursting out from this beautiful dress, which she did so beautifully. And then once they had finished under the chuppah and they'd smashed the glass, she gets to take off her veil and she's allowed to look at her husband really as a husband for the first time. Right. And then they go downstairs again to celebrate.
And there's men during the wedding. And you have you've replicated these mink hats. Let's bring up the next image here, because there is an enormous amount of complexities in order to create this. The mink hats, and you weren't able to just go buy them, were you?
They do sell them in Williamsburg in New York. They've got a lot of very lovely hat shops, actually. But I had been clocked on the street as being an outsider, and I was having trouble getting into those shops.
Not in their stores anymore.
They didn't want me there. But I did get into Shrymol hat shop, and I did have a chance to actually hold one and look at it and really see how it was constructed, which was fantastic because it meant that I could then go away and recreate that hat out of fake fur, which is what I did.
It's not like you can just go buy coats for the gentleman and shirts off the rack from a regular store. What is that about?
So what people don't know about Hasidic Jewish clothing is that they dress, their buttons go from right over left, the way women do in our fashion, and men go left over right. And it's to do with, in the Jewish concept of who they are, the right side is kindness and the left side is judgment. So kindness has to go on top of judgment, which is quite beautiful, really.
Yeah.
But difficult for a costume designer because they can't cheat. You can't cheat and just go, ooh, let's get a black coat. You have to get one that buttons the right way. So, I had to buy those all actually from the dry goods shop in Williamsburg.
Justine, before we talk about Essie's transition into Germany and becoming part of a new society, could you talk a little bit about your choices in your color palette and why you chose to work within a certain color palette?
It was very important to separate the two worlds. So the first part of the world where Essie's a young woman and I dressed her as she was much younger and I tried to make her look younger, which was very easy because she does look very young.
Yeah.
So the school uniform and then the house dresses. I chose colors that were muted and you could put it that I went for more of a sort of a 70s palette with olive greens and dusty, beautiful rose colors and lemon yellows or mustard colors.
And then Essie goes to Berlin and it's so poignant and beautiful. It's like layers of her life from Brooklyn start peeling off little by little. And I was just going to ask like how you shifted over and how you started to introduce more color into her life.
Well, she arrives in Berlin wearing one of her traditional modesty dresses that she left in, which I actually needed it to go through a whole gamut of that transition because she ends up in the water in it. And I wanted that to be really quite a sharp shock, like that stood out in the streets of Berlin, which it did beautifully. And then everyone else around her was just colorful and carefree and, you know, you could show whatever you wanted, you could do whatever you want, you can wear whatever you want, and it's a big party town and there's lots of free love and whatever else you can imagine. And it was quite a shock to Essie as she first arrived. And then she's sort of welcomed into this beautiful community of musicians and they're lovely and they're interested and they're just open to her and they're not judgmental really. And so what I hoped to achieve was that she kind of observed these new friends of hers and then stole ideas from them and then went shopping herself and incorporated what she'd observed just on that first day of meeting them and emulated them to try and fit in and to try and start the transition. And I had spoken to Deborah Feldman, I interviewed her right at the beginning as well, and asked her what it was like to move from modesty clothing into the clothing that we wear, which is much more, you know, body hugging and, freer. And she said it took her years to kind of be comfortable in clothes that showed off a bit more, that weren't quite so modest or private, really. And so I tried to show that with Essie, and I kept pieces of Williamsburg, so like the first time she actually wears a different outfit, she still has a scarf around her neck to kind of link her hair. And then the dresses are, none of them are short, none of them are sleeveless, and I kept a couple of the color palettes there as well. You might have noticed that I used like a rusty colored dress when she goes to dinner, which is the same rusty sort of dress that she when she first met her husband. So I pushed her back and forwards a little bit, playing with colors. But the rest of Berlin, I just wanted to make it just a, you know, cosmopolitan, vibrant city full of people that were just coming together without any prejudices. And the Muslims were playing music, and the Jews were playing music, and they all were playing German music, and in this school of music that was just, you know, a celebration of life and culture and art.
Well, it's really sophisticated costume designing what you've accomplished in Unorthodox. And her essay's evolution is so reflected in her veneer of what she chooses as a character to wear in each scene. And then you have these rich, rich, big, wide shots of the community in the Orthodox community. And then you have equally rich, wide shots when they end up at the conservatory in Berlin. So it is absolutely fantastic design. And we will be hoping that there is an Emmy nod for you for this project. So
that would
now
be amazing.
We're going to come back together with all of our designers, but now we're going to transition over to our next guest, who is Michelle Cole, who has 6 Emmy nominations for In Living Color and has 2 for Blackish. And I'd like to welcome Michelle Cole, and we're going to take a look at her work on Kenya Barris's new Netflix comedy, Black AF.
Hey guys.
KB, what's up, dog?
Thank you guys for hopping on this call. I think we have to be able to talk honestly if we want our art to progress. What do you think about my show, Blackish?
It's fine.
Uh-huh.
Blackish seems to tap into the hearts and minds of 55-year-old white women.
Guess there was no ride-along, too.
Oh, whoa, is that what we're doing now?
Dude, you literally say no to nothing.
I probably would have said no to Night School.
Oh, I'm sorry. Night School made $100 million, so you'd have been saying no to that, sir.
So I'm making this documentary about my family. And they kind of stick out. Just keep this long and loose. I want you to catch everything. There's a lot of us.
And these are our parents.
Let's go.
It's just the diaper, Mommy.
You're such a bad mom. Whatever question you ask, the answer is because of slavery. It's my North Star. The chains, the cars.
I begged him not to get it. Begged him.
She said she begged me?
Now, I swear to God, if you don't buy this shit, I will go f*** somebody with this exact same car. That's how I felt.
When you were mixed mother, you were constantly tested on your blackness. Name the Fab Five. Name the Jackson Five. Name all the members of the Wayans family. Do you know? No.
Mom, come on. You're the whitest person I know.
Hey, at least if you're gonna shoot a gun, shoot it like that. Have you ever seen Boys in the Hood? Let's go. I mean, we might argue.
Great earrings. What are those, door knockers?
Amongst ourselves.
Remind me to change my will.
But if you come for our family.
Hi, babe.
Hey, Mom.
Look at that hair, purple.
You're gonna get that smoke.
So hip hop, girl.
Liddy.
Lady, you don't want that smoke.
Anyway, what were you saying about your tiny house with no electricity?
Blah, blah, blah. Brr, brr. Wow. What is all this?
Just little swag bags for kids at the party.
Samsung watches, earbuds, Fendi keychains? Are the kids Golden Globe nominees?
Just little knickknacks. Relax, dude.
That's crazy. This will be a great place to play Count the Black People.
That'll be a very short game.
Incredibly short. Hi,
I needed some shit with some bopping.
Hey, what's up, cut? Wanna holler at you about something? Look, my life, shit like a movie. It's like Deep Cover meets Juana Man. It's your classic comedy about a man putting on a wig.
Tootsie.
Something like it hot. Miss Doubtfire. Rest in peace, Robin Williams.
I mean it like ever since Baby on Baby Drop, man. Ever like, since Baby on know, Baby Drop. You know.
Michelle, welcome. Michelle Cole. So talk about like costume, cacophony of color and prints and bold choices. It's like night and day from a world trapped in time to a world just exploding with excitement, especially costume excitement.
Yeah.
Let's start with, what is your process for creating the look of this affluent family with 6 crazy kids and a mom and dad who just
are crazy.
Totally fun.
It's I have a great boss, Kenya Barris, and Rashida Jones is our executive producer of the show. And when we first started, we sat down for about a couple of hours and we talked about their characters. We talked the sets, each child, and you know, this is Kenya's story. So he does have six children. So I based a little bit on each one of his children, and they, you know.
Let's pull up the image of the family. This is when they're at the Four Seasons having brunch and causing chaos in the Four Seasons. But you have, like, even Kenya is wearing a very bold choice in sweat attire.
He has a bold personality. He's a black man that's made it. He's done extremely well.
Yeah.
And he's going to show that. And you know, our culture is a little bit where when we make it, we like to shine a little bit. And I think he has a Gucci jacket on there.
Yes.
And that was actually his personal, because we went through his closet, and so we got that from his closet. So that was his personal piece. And I've received so many phone calls about that jacket, where people wanted to get that jacket. But it was a great, we did each one, and Julie Moss is my assistant designer on this. Mm-hmm. And we went through each character, we had one child that had Burberry top on, Moschino. We had all different looks for them when they did that scene, because we wanted to project that this was a well-to-do family. Rashida Jones, her character is an attorney. And so the oldest kid is going to USC. So they're educated, they're smart, they're urban, they're chic, they're stylish. And I think that that's what we wanted to present, is that we were a little loud in some of our colors. And I think and the house is all gray inside. Maxine Shepherd.
And it gives you a blank palette, so you can even add more. It doesn't get any better.
Yeah, so it was great. And when you do hair and makeup and you see the youngest one having beads in his hair with all these different colors, it just shined. And it was just a great show to work on, and to display all your texture and just to have fun with it.
And then our next slide. So Kenya Barris, he's not timid about all of these sweat outfits. This one, I think, is a Fendi. You had the Gucci. Mm-hmm. It's like every major brand on the high end scale end up on his body in all of his sweatsuits and leisure wear.
Yes, he is a man that he's tall. He's about 6'2", and he lost about 30 pounds when we did this. So we really got a chance to really excel and go out there and have fun with it. And he ended up wearing, you know, from Louis Vuitton to Gucci, Off-White, Fear of God, Givenchy. So we had so much fun, but it wasn't so much about the labels. He just wears clothes really well. And he zips up his sweat top. So it gives him this kind of really cool, chic kind of look when he does that. But he is a person, has a big personality. He's a visionary. He's political. He has a voice. So I think that's what we tried to project when we did his character. That's what he wanted to project.
And when the patriarch of a household like this is already at the top of the scale of luxury and color, where does that lead you with Rashida? Let's take a look at one of the images we have of her with her son Pops.
Yeah, we did color on her. I'm, you know, that's one thing I'm probably not afraid of, is color and texture. So when you set the line and you set the look of it, the show, and you're getting ready for it, it's a judgment. I don't know how to explain it. It was, we went from, if we had Kenya in red, then someone might be in orange, and there was a pattern, there was different kind of color. So we just kind of have fun with it. I don't think I have rules. I kind of have these unlimited, I can excel outside of my box. And I think that's what we do. So I don't kind of put a lot of restrictions on myself. And I have a great team of people that have great taste. And so we really collaborated to do this. So, and each person had a really great style. So I didn't even mind if they matched, long they were in a different pattern. Because it is hard to put eight people in a show. Yeah.
And not end up with them all in burgundy or all in red.
Yes.
Yeah.
Yes. So
quite
it is
challenging.
So we, yeah. So we, I, We just took the license. We just had fun with it, and we did it, and it came out really, and it came out really well. So really,
and how is it working with the two older daughters? Their clothes are just as amazing as their Rashida's costumes.
Well, the oldest one is US. You know, she goes to USC. Yeah. She's a little bit. She's out there. You know, where she is exploring life and has a boyfriend, and her sister Drea just got into NYU. So we put her in cords, rag and bone, a lot of sweaters. Kind of, Kenya has a line where he makes fun of her. He goes, "What do you have on, cords?" So we kind of
getting ready for her life, her new life in New York City.
Yeah. So that was where we did a lot of patterns with her. And so that was what we did more with her character than the oldest one. The other one is a little sexier. She's a little bit in tune with her body. So we definitely had a different, and she was really great too. We did a lot of Zara on her. You know, we mixed a lot of high and low. Yes.
It's like Michelle Obama. If she can wear it, we could all wear it too. Yes. I love doing that. It's pretty fabulous.
Yes. I love mixing flowers and patterns.
Yeah. Yeah. Mm-hmm. And then you had probably one of those amazing experiences on this show, I would assume, where you got to go on an actual vacation with your TV family of Black AF. So where did you all end up?
Fiji.
Yeah, it doesn't get any better.
Fiji, they were there. I think they were there. I was there for a week. They were there for about 3 weeks. So
and
it was pretty incredible.
How many trunks did you have to haul into Fiji?
Well, we the script was really, really good for us, because what happens is that we didn't have a lot of changes. So I don't know. Devin Patterson's my supervisor. I don't know how much we packed, but we were there until like 1 o'clock in the morning trying to get it all out in e-carts. And so it was a lot, because we had triples of and it's humid there. So we had triples on some of their clothes.
And there's no way you can clean it unless you clean it in the ocean.
No. And once you ship over to Fiji, if I can remember this correctly,
you can't get it out.
Yeah. Right. So we had to be really careful. There's all these rules and laws there, but we had a fantastic time.
And let's look at the photo of them all getting onto the airplane. They didn't fly on. You guys took a commercial plane, or you flew on this plane?
No, that was just for the shot. No.
It's so pretty. But look at the kids. Look amazing in there.
Yeah. Yeah. I'm really proud of that. I mean, when I look at that, I have a really big smile. And I think this is Kenya, one of his favorite shots too. He likes this shot. But I love all the colors. I love exploring. I think it looks really great. It looks really chic. It looks like a really rich family. But this rich family relates to a lot of other people. You know, they relate to others, and they're not beyond where they're better than somebody. I love that about them. Like, they're always trying to figure it out as a family. They love each other. They argue. They call their dad on his, you know, on his stuff. And so they call him out on it. And I love that they do that, that they, they're not the norm, you know, they're not the normal family.
No, it's not a cookie cutter. That's
no,
for sure.
And I think that's the reason why this show's been so successful, is because it works this way for them. So, and they do a good job raising these kids.
Let's take a look at the last image that we have for look at him.
Yeah.
So how on earth, even in the South Pacific, Kenya ends up in a silk tropical
Gucci
shirt.
Yeah. Yeah. And that was on, and we, and that's on a private island. We shot that on another private island. So how many people wear a Gucci silk shirt on the beach?
No way.
So that's what we wanted to, I mean, he looks great there. The kids look great there. And I just love this. I just love the stripes, the flowers, the boldness of the colors. And he's just so bold there. And that's his character. He just talks with his hands. He's tall, and he just has this boldness about himself.
Yeah.
And
yeah.
And that's what, and he can wear that. I mean, Kenya can wear it. So when you have an actor that can just wear just about anything, it's fun to have. It's a great time to have fun with it, you know. So it was a lot of fun.
So I heard through one of the interviews that I looked at is that Kenya refers to you as his costume wizard. And I would suspect part of that is that you are doing three of his projects all at the same time. Blackish,
yes.
Growish, Black AF.
Mm-hmm.
How does that work?
You know, we have Blackish and Grownish on the same lot. at ABC. So that does help. And they're also in Blackish, it was in its sixth season, and Grownish was in its third season. So those characters are established, you know, and we still shop, you know, we still do. I'm there for all, like, all the fittings. I have a great team of people, but my eyes are on everything. Before everything goes to the set, I see it. I'm on the phone, FaceTiming. So I have a really great crew on all three shows. And I have a great boss that lets me kind of, you know, do my own thing a little bit. So I don't have to show him everything so much on Blackish and Grownish as much anymore. But AF, Black AF, he was very much involved in, usually first season shows with him. He's extremely involved. He looks at all the research.
Wasn't he FaceTiming you to, like, find out what was in his trailer for that day to wear?
His first day on the job in my, as my actor, because this is our first time. He was my actor, my lead actor. He wasn't my creator or my executive producer. So it was funny. And I was like, first thing in the morning, I get this ring, and I'm like looking, going, oh God, can you FaceTiming me? And he's like, where's my clothes? You know, I said, they're in your trailer. So that's one of my special moments with him, when I'd like, he's an actor. It's official. He's an actor now.
Well, thank you for sharing all of that. We're going to come back together as a group in a minute. Okay. And now we're going to take a look at Beth Morgan's work on GLOW.
So how's Vegas?
Black magic.
Seven, winner.
It's been nice, you know? Me being wrong about you hating Vegas.
Business is good. We've sold out for the next 2 weeks.
What do you think of Sandy?
She's the entertainment director.
Have a drink and play a little blackjack on us.
And keep this up, and the three of us stand to make a lot of money here.
Maybe I can push the money into a pile the shape of my son.
Okay, well, I don't really know what to say to that.
I have a job. I have a boyfriend. And somehow, I still feel lost.
Maybe you feel lost because you're holding yourself back.
I would like to extend GLOW's contract until the end of the year. It's stuck!
What the fuck is happening now?
God, I love opening nights.
This is everything we've ever wanted.
We can't grow to bear for another 9 months.
I'm the only one who cares about keeping the show alive. I know there's
something in the way. What do you want, Ruth?
I don't want to ruin what we have.
If it wasn't for Bash, then none of us would even be sitting here today.
You're happy, right? Listen to your
heart. We may never open a show in Las Vegas ever again. Just take a moment and appreciate what is right in front of you.
I'm gonna get us kicked out of every casino here before we leave.
This place can make you a little crazy.
We're so lucky to all be here together.
Some things are worth fighting for.
Let me out. I can't take it. Oh, no. Seriously. I'm gonna.
Sam,
I'm
come
taking
on,
the stairs. I'm
fit.
Taking the stairs.
Welcome, Beth.
That's so fun to see together.
Isn't it great? Yeah. So first, I just want to point out that this is your third season as the costume designer on GLOW. You have 2 Emmy nominations and 3 Costume Design Guild Awards. Several
nominations, but
nominations.
Like, yes.
And you're, so 1980, Gorgeous Ladies of Wrestling, they leave California. And now they're in Las Vegas.
Yeah.
Does it get any better?
It doesn't get any better. I mean, each season of GLOW has been its own progression and time. Like, we started in 85, and like every time we kind of like jump a year, you know, within the seasons, it's a very short time period, usually like a couple of months. So this was the first time in season 3 where we like spend a whole year examining their experience. And I think as a person that started in theater and like that repetition of every night, 7 days, you know,
it's like doing a Broadway gig.
Yeah. I mean, that's why I started. My first job was as a wardrobe supervisor at the Pasadena Playhouse. And like, I remember just like, you know, some of the shows and, you know, that was a roadhouse. So things would go through faster. And like sometimes by the third week, you're like happily singing along to Jerry Herman. And sometimes you're like, if I hear this song again, I'm going to really lose my mind. So it was really fun to examine that experience of what it's like to be playing a character over and over and over every night. And so, yeah, it was fun to spend that time with them. And also in Vegas, which is so glamorous and so different than our gym.
You get to have the opportunity in the beginning of season three that you actually get a flashback of these incredible iconic costumes that were created for a wedding scene the season before. Tell us about, let's bring up the image of the women at the gambling table.
Yeah, this is such a fun image for so many reasons. So in the end of season two ends with a wedding. And I've spoken about this before, but like the atmosphere of working on GLOW is such an amazing collaborative process from like top down. And so because of that, by the time season two came around, like I had such a comfortable rapport with my showrunners and our executive producers and how they really made me as an artist feel seen and appreciated and like really felt like I as a costume designer brought a layer. So when this scene from season two was scripted, it was originally scripted that the girls would be in their iconic GLOW looks like Zoya or Melrose or whatever, you know, their regular look. And I went in and asked them if I could pitch them an idea. And I said, okay, I'll come back. I don't want to say anything. And we had my sketch artist do a sketch. It's all the girls drawn like
Karen Yan, right?
Yeah, Karen Yan.
Yeah.
It was amazing. And she was like, I don't have big enough paper. We had to do it very quickly. And I was like, don't worry. And like, she does watercolor and she's like, it's getting wrinkly. I'm like, it's perfect. It's perfect. You know, she's like such a perfectionist and does such an amazing job. So I took this, you know, very large sketch of all the girls with Rhonda in the middle with the bridesmaids dresses, leotards to Liz and Carly, our creators, and said, I think it's so much more fun to do this because, you know, bridesmaids dresses in real life are such a snapshot of a moment in time for costumes. It's like, you know, 80s, it's like such an iconic moment of the huge ruffle.
Chaos.
And the veils with the peak right through the forehead. And so these things are like such a, you know, like a glimpse at that time. And, you know, our show, this was before we were in Vegas when we were doing the season two, it's not about the 80s glitz and glamour. It's very much about these people that don't have a lot of money, who are trying to make ends meet and things work. Some of them have more than others, but like we're not to the late 80s of, you know, the hair rock and like the really neon color. So it was fun to like really get to do something that was so iconically 80s. And, you know, there is that moment when you're a bridesmaid for your friend that might be making a bad decision. Yeah. Like Rhonda's marrying somebody she doesn't know. Like,
doesn't even know him.
Yeah. But like you show up for your girl, you wear, and like
you're right.
15 girls, 12 girls in all the same outfit, even like some fits it better than others. I mean, it's just like very true to life of like what it is to be in a wedding. So, and you know, my team at the time, it was Allie Casey was my assistant and Jessica Lawson and Valerie like made those, like they were so hard to engineer because they're all such different sizes. And I was adamant that they go off the shoulders when they walk down the aisle and then go on their shoulders when they wrestle. So like, you can imagine, I mean, there's so much that went into it. And like, it was
they are genius.
Was like such a collaboration of like, it's going to have to be fast, but we want it to be perfect. And like all the actors were like done for the season and they came to 2 and 3 and 4 more fittings to make it perfect. So like everybody really got behind this idea that I had. And so it was one of the most satisfying moments creatively, like to stand up in Sam's office and like watch the battle royale of them all fighting and just like ruffles everywhere. And so they were only supposed to be used for that scene. And so when the next season, when I got the script and they were in there, I was like, guys, you know, those aren't made to last.
Like, and again, and again, and again. Yeah.
And we had to use them, you know, for a whole nother season, but we were happy that, that people responded to them.
And then you also talk about like 80s eye candy, then you get to have a new actress added to your incredible cast of the iconic Gina Davis. Let's pull up the image. So her outfits throughout the season, each one is more a bold statement about the 80s than the one before. Are they from different collections? Where on earth did you find all of these?
They're from different collections. You know, we really kind of run the gamut when we are shopping for Glow. So like the leopard print two-piece suit that she wears in the beginning, I'm forgetting where exactly we got it from, but we go to so many different places in LA and online and Etsy and dealers. And that piece was like, she had this amazing Gucci belt with it. She's so tall, but she's like a wizard. Like you could fit in something. She fits in something that doesn't make sense. It's like, she's magic.
And
like,
she just pulls it off.
Oh, and she pulls it. And she is the most game actress I've ever witnessed. So she's, you know, an icon for so many different reasons, but she's so inspiring as a feminist. And so like to have her even in the fitting room and somebody that I grew up watching was so fun. And, you know, she was so iconic in the 80s. You know, we had such a great time in the fitting room, and she really like, we wanted to make sure to like show her as a inspiration and like for Debbie. So like that Debbie sees what life could be. And, you know,
as a producer,
and like Sandy was a dancer, and she found a way, you know, I think it's very inspiring for all women. Like, as we talk about costume designers, maybe like, how do you see your future and how do you pivot to continue to create when maybe you age out of a certain thing? So she's really an inspiration in that aspect, but like, we wanted her to still be, use her body in a way. Like, she's always cinched in, it's low cut. It's always a choice that feels, not overly sexualized, but definitely that she is aware that her body at this moment in the 80s is an asset.
Right.
So like,
right.
You know, that men still are, you know, very, have a power over the women, even in the corporate, and she's in a, you know, in Vegas in a corporate setting. It's like she is playing the game.
She owns it. She owns the cost. She carries those costumes beautifully and owns that position of authority seamlessly.
Yeah.
It's so incredible.
Yeah. She was so fun to dress. And it's fun to like show Vegas compared to LA at the, our version of LA, which is a valley at the time. It's like Vegas is very much, you know, like people then, and when you're going to Vegas, like you bought a new cocktail dress to wear to the show. Everything was glistening. So like to be able to show that,
like
really
in the
like
elevator
dynasty.
Scene in the, in the trailer, you see the girls are not so ragtag as they were in Los Angeles. It's like you have a whole new color palette, a whole new dynamics of what their clothes are and where they're acquiring them.
Yeah. And they have money. They're making money. Like they have never really made money yet doing this. It's like, they know, not only are they getting paid, but they know they're going to continue to get paid. So, you know, they really have a reason to celebrate, and all of them, it was so fun to see all their different unique choices and what they would, but you know, it's the same challenge as like Michelle was just talking about. There's a lot of girls and they're, you know, like, so you got to make sure you really differentiate their characters and the color palette and that it all works together. And like, you know, they're always in scenes together. So that's a constant challenge that we have of like making sure their individual styles are really showing through and that making sure everything works together. So it's a fun challenge.
Yeah, the elevator shows how fun it can be, and especially when they squeeze Sam out.
Yeah.
It's pretty great.
Well, and Sam even himself, like he's really stuck in the 70s. So like I got a 70s velvet tuxedo with the oversized bow tie, and he looks so fantastic in it. And so it's fun to play with the difference of like, you know, we have like Melrose and Donna Stacey kind of more on the cusp of fashion, and then all the way back to Sam that's like stuck in the mid 70s.
Let's take a look at a couple of the costumes that you created for the last episode that takes place over Christmas.
Yes.
And you come up with a whole Christmas theme.
Yeah.
So now you've got your Christmas Barbie doll.
Yes. We it was like very, I think it was scripted that like Rosemary Clooney from A White Christmas, which is also one of Betty, the actress's favorite movies, and this dress Valerie made in-house, and she's such a talented cutter fitter. It fit so perfectly, and it's so beautiful on camera. And there's like a moment where Betty walks out, and you know when your actor really is like selling it for you, and it's such a good feeling.
She steals the frame when she walks in.
She walks out and she like does a twirl with her skirt, and it's just like, you know, it's such a amazing feeling when you can tell the actor feels so comfortable and so excited about their look. So for us, it's like just to put all the girls together and
And then let's take a look at Allison and Kia. So Allison's like completely like her little waif.
The thing about this episode, what we wanted to show is how scrappy our girls still are. So they want to do a Christmas show for, it's for the Secret Santa. And so they have to come together with what they have there. But the lucky thing about being in Vegas is it's a show town. There's a resource of people that you can go to. When all of a sudden in episode, I think it's 5 on Freaky Friday, when all of a sudden Sheila comes back as Liza Minnelli, like a minute later, but it's believable because she went to go see Bobby and Bobby always is dressed as Liza. So we wanted to play that same thing. So in that photo, Kia's in her welfare queen coat. So we're like, oh, that plays so great as a ghost of Christmas future. And we could believe that there's ribbons that they got off the tree in the lobby and they made this thing and that, it's easy to go through the boxes backstage and find a sleeping cap and thing. So we wanted to really play to the reality of them putting this together pretty quickly. And what would the resources they would have in Vegas to do that and how they would, I feel like at the end of every season, it's our girls coming together to make a show.
And we have an image of them all coming together. Let's take a look at this. So here's the whole composition. It just doesn't get any better.
Oh my, it's so fun to watch this and just remember the stories and the struggles, because of the wrestling. So Dawn and Stacy, Arthie and Dawn, who play the Ghost of Christmas Past, and they have the candles on their head. I really wanted those, and they can't wrestle in them. And they always find a way. We early on brought them to rehearsal, and they're like, "Well, we can't do a role in this. We can't." And they're like, "We're just gonna take them off and throw them." So my actresses are so game to always make it work for me, and so it's such a collaboration across the board of when they see, I think they see it in my eyes when I really want something, and they're like, "Don't worry, Beth. We'll make it work." Same with Allie's stocking cap. She has her Zoya mohawk underneath there, and she's like, "Beth, Carmen pulls my hair. How am I going to make this work?" And she sees it, and luckily T, our hair
just
artist,
got it.
She's
just
like, "Oh, got it. Here, two bobby pins. Well, don't worry." So it really is a beautiful show to be on because it really is about a full collaboration with everybody.
Well, fittings with your performers I wish I could be a fly on the wall. It must be a joy watching you collaborate with all of them because they own it. I mean, they're very vulnerable in those outfits and they all seem to own it and just feel like, yeah, I got this. No problem.
Well, from day one of putting on tiny little leotards, everybody always felt so happy and so celebrating each other. It's such a empowering set to be on. Anytime one of the girls comes out in a new outfit that somebody might consider vulnerable, they're all clapping and yelling at each other. And so it really has been set the bar from the beginning of an empowering environment, never to feel, to be proud of your body and to really feel celebrated yourself and have other people celebrate you. So it's been a joy.
Well, thank you for sharing that. Now let's bring our other two panelists back. And why don't we talk about something that each of you have touched on, is that you are key visual collaborators for the team. Mm-hmm. And I wanted to see, do you ever discover moments where you find these costume pieces like the pink outfits for the bridesmaids? I'm sure as you're hunting and gathering, it can be in the most expensive stores on the planet to the thrift stores and buying by the pound. How does that sort of relationship and that discovery process then work when you're collaborating with your producers, showrunners, writers?
I mean, it's all very organic for us. It's especially, I'm sure you guys have this experience too, but there's a limited resources, even though it's 80s and it's not, 20s where there's even less resources. I think that there's an understanding of we can find what we can find, we can make what we can make. And it all is a very organic experience to get to the final product. And
Mm-hmm. And Michelle, how do you feel about, you seem to have a very good relationship with your, with the writing team and the directors.
I think Beth really hit it when she was talking about her show. It's when you're when you have a great, when you have really great creators of a show mm-hmm. that allow you to, you know, to really get out there, really stretch, and you, and they let you have your vision. It's not always about their vision. You can, like she said, walking up and saying, this is how I see it. And Kenya's very good about that. He lets you play. He lets you do your thing. And so I think that all three of us probably are, I work best when creators let me do my thing. When you kind of hold me back, then I kind of, I get shy and bit, but I'm pretty big. Like, I have a pink suit on right now. Yeah. It's like, so I'm not afraid of things like that. So you kind of have to calm me down, you know, to like bring it down less. So Kenya's like, bring it down a little bit.
Oh, it's great. It's great. Yeah. And Justine, how about when you were buying all this stuff by the pound and digging in piles of rag collections?
Well, yeah, the difference is that mine is a limited season, so it's only 4 hours of television. So I don't have that ongoing relationship of how we work together for years and years. But I had to buy all the women's clothes secondhand because of my budgetary restraints, and so I was doing pick and set, pick and weigh, which is, you know, choose your pieces and weigh it. And I went for just a really basic color palette, and I really used that within the Williamsburg section. And I offered a few different options. I couldn't offer many options, but I had very, very generous collaborators. Anna Vinger was very trusting, and Maria Schreider, the director, was, they all weighed in. We had three women and Alexa Karolinski, and they all weighed in with their opinions, and between me, them, and the actor, we found what would work. But yes, I was sort of driving the ship of how it looked, and they gave me that freedom.
But I think that's a good point, though, you bring up, Justine, is like sometimes, and because of the 80s too, I feel like the endless possibilities sometimes of what you can bring really can water down the design. It's so like if you have to really concentrate on these small things that and make more minor choices, it really can keep the design more pure. I think if producers know that there's endless possibilities and you can go and go, like sometimes it's like, oh, well, what if that was orange? It's like, no, it's actually perfect as it is. Yes, but the budget is.
And I think also it's really important that, you know, we have the entire show in our brain and we have the storyline, the story arc going into our brain. And if somebody comes in and goes, oh, can't we make that green?
Yeah.
It's just going to knock out that story arc. And so what I like to do is actually put the story arc of the number one across the wall and then bring in my creatives and say, this is what's happening and this is what I'm going to build around. It's like a jigsaw puzzle. You know, she's our one piece and everything else fits around it. Yeah. And when they can see it, obviously, it's displayed like that visually on the wall, then, you know, jaws drop and they're like, I get the story now. I see what you're doing. And then you can go.
That's like the benefit of limited series or feature compared to series. It's like, you know, I don't know, Michelle, if you guys had all your scripts, but, you know, we're getting scripts as we go. It's such a benefit, I think, to having like, you know, the whole arc and like, usually we do know information before we start the season to be able to, but like, you know, it's all these different ways of telling a story that we,
I was lucky because it was based on a book. So even though we didn't have the final scripts at hand, I kind of knew what her storyline was going to be. So it was very different. Whereas the show I'm on at the moment, it's the same. It's like, so what happens? What happens to that outfit next episode? Because I need to know how many I need.
Exactly.
But it's even like, you know, when you're doing contemporary, like Black AF, you still have a vision of like how you see the whole show, like how you see them at home, how you see them outside. Like there's times where Kenya, and you know, Devin Patterson, and there was times that my supervisor would run to the set saying, Kenya, you don't change in this scene. This is not the scene that you change in. And he said, but I would change. And Kenya is that person that would change in the middle of the day. You know, so and it was going to throw supervisors off. They like come out screaming like, no. Yes. But it's his show. It's his show. And if he changes, because if you notice, you haven't seen the show, but it's like four seasons, when we're setting that shot up, the four seasons, they come home and they change clothes again.
Right.
Yeah. So, yeah, right. They come home and they have clothes, new clothes on. So
how very Jane Austen.
Yeah. But you do have a vision for the whole show, which is good. And I'm like you, I'm probably Beth as well, is where you have the board set up and you have your look set up for each actor, and you keep going, referring back to them throughout the season. Mm-hmm. Yeah. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Now, I'd like to, before we run out of time, I would love to hear some words of wisdom for our younger audience who's part of watching this event. Beth, you worked your way up starting as an assistant costume designer on Deadwood, Django, and John Adams. Mm-hmm. Michelle, you are theater trained. You broke into the business with Rhett Turner and Aaron Spelling's TV shows. And Justine, you started in the art department on big, iconic Australian films like Moulin Rouge and Mission Impossible while going to college. Mm. So for all three of you, like myself, you all started from that bottom rung and negotiated and navigated your way into this business to being these incredible costume designers with these beautiful, rich careers. Do you have words of advice or insight on how to break into this business for our graduating class of 2020 MFA designers?
For me, it's persistence. Mm-hmm. I mean, I just not giving up, just being persistent, pursuing that costume designer, going in working free. Can I come and hang out with you for a day? I get a lot of interns. A lot of people will call me students. And that's one thing I love to do is they come in for two or three. I don't allow them to come in for the whole day because it gets really busy, but they'll come in for 2 or 3 hours. And they get to see the dynamics of like what it takes to run a show. So they'll stay for about 2 or 3 hours with us. And I usually have 2 or 3 kids that come, 2 or 3 students that come in.
That's fantastic.
And they come in. Yeah. So they come in and that's an opportunity to, you know, to meet. And I take them to the set, take them to Grownish, Blackish, you know, Black
AF.
Right. So it gets, but you have to be persistent. You have to have confidence. There's times I need answers and I have to go, I kind of got to barge into the writer's room. You have to have confidence to do that, because I need an answer. My actress, she's getting ready to change clothes.
Yeah.
And, so I think that, and that's also, you know, you experience that, that's something that comes with the turf.
And so Beth, what do you think?
Well, it's so funny because I was one of those people that went to Michelle's set when I was 22. I came out to LA from Columbia College in Chicago. They have a semester in LA program and we were on the Radford lot and she was doing Bernie Mac and we as she's talking about confidence, I went up to her in the cafeteria and I was like, I love your work. This was Post and Moving Color, which was like, you know, Bob Mackie and Michelle Cole, the reason I wanted to be costume designer.
Yeah.
And she took me and I think one other student into Bernie Mac. Yeah. And like, I remember vividly, like the morning meeting, you were down. Remember that place?
Yes,
down
the there? Basement. Like, the basement. The basement.
And like, you know, we got to watch. And so it was those experiences that really helped me. Like, you know, that program was so great. It's similar to what you guys do at UCLA, where you have a lot of working costume designers come in and tell their stories.
We do.
Yeah. And so I went on to be the, you know, Maggie Morgan was a mentor of mine. And then I went on to do, but like my real piece of advice is like, just don't turn any jobs down. You know, like the thing is I did free jobs. Like I would go on Craigslist and Mandy.com. I did like USC films. You know, I had the luxury because I was working theater in the evening. So I had some income and like doing these free jobs. And like, you know, I've done plenty of jobs in the entertainment industry that were not ideal in the end, but I always would learn something from them. And like my connections, like my job on GLOW, I mean, I got the job on my merit of my interview, but like I got in the room because a friend of mine that I'd done a Yahoo web series with knew the producer. So like you don't like, you know, everybody gets to where they deserve to be by their hard work, but like sometimes it's like, how do you get in the room where it happens? Like that, like it can be many different ways that we can get into that room. So I think by all experiences, like you can think it's like, oh, this job is not worth it. But like, you know, if there's a reason, you know, what is it, like money, creative, or relationships? Like those are the three reasons to take jobs. And I think if you really, you know, try to not just take them for money, but you know, it happens. Like what did Ruth Carter say at the Guild Awards? It's like, sometimes you got to pay the mortgage. Like that's reality. And, you know, and like, sometimes you take them, there's a ton of creative, but there's no money, but you know, you know, it's really about assessing, and, you know, yeah, like not feeling above jobs as you're starting out. It's like, you know, I've done plenty of jobs out of my trunk of my car.
Well, and then Justine, if I understand correctly, you were doing soft goods for the art department. How did you get from Australia over to two other continents and then work your way up?
Well, yes, it was a big jump, but I kind of got to the level I could get to in Australia. I'm English, but I was in Australia. And once I had done my first six features, I moved to Los Angeles, and Americans do not recognize foreign credits like that. So I started doing film school films when I got to LA, and it was tough. I'd done six features and two television shows, and there I was working on film school student films, which was fun. And that's what I would say to anyone who wants to get into this industry. Don't think it's going to be easy, and don't think those walk down the red carpets are what life is about. It's really, really hard work. It's incredibly fascinating and educational, and it's actually quite addictive. And it's a lot of fun, and you meet a lot of amazing people. But my advice would be to always be creative, be observant, look at your environment, look at everywhere you go, and notice what people are doing and what is special about that person that makes them look the way they do or tells the story of who they are to you. And take notes, always take notes. Yeah. And then when you do have your first story, take your first main character, and then you build around that character's design so that you never overlap. And always ask why. Why did I make that decision? So that when you go and have that discussion with the showrunner or the director, you've got a total backstory as to what your design is. And once you can support your design ideas, that's when you're going to be taken seriously.
Well, thank you. It's all of them very, very helpful and poignant for our audience. Costume designers, I cannot thank you enough for being our panelists for today. Thank you to Justine Seymour, Unorthodox, Michelle Cole, Black AF, and Beth Morgan on GLOW. Thanks again for sharing your costume design process and your wisdom, insight. And to our audience, check out all these shows on Netflix. I wish you all the best of luck at this year's Emmy considerations. And thank you again.
Thanks, everybody.
Thank you. Thank you. Nice.